usual, it's business on steroids inside the Beltway. About the only place where politics is not business as usual, where the silent majority is being heard, is in the state houses and the local communities. New Jersey's leading the way, where Governor Christie's battle against public sector unions is finally paying off, leading to a deal that even Democrats have finally accepted. Wisconsin's governor and legislature are now winning court battles to do what the voters asked them to do. Even Chicago and California are showing some signs of getting public sector unions to cry uncle. But in Washington, D.C., the payoffs to special interests are still the order of the day. So how do we get the people's voice heard inside the Beltway? Let's ask Oklahoma City Mayor Mick Cornett and Florida Senate President Mike Haridopolos, who is also a Republican candidate for the U.S. Senate. Senator, let me go to you first. Once they go inside the Beltway, politicians seem to enter this sort of cone of silence through which you can't hear what the constituents want. Why is that? Why is it that folks inside the Beltway are not at all focused on what the people want?
Well, I'm not exactly sure. It's very frustrating. What we do here in Florida is we open it up to the people. We are the Sunshine State. And then the major reforms that we made in our state with pensions, with Medicaid, and of course education, we took it directly to the people in town hall meetings, opened up meetings so we could hear from the people directly as opposed to coming down on high.
But you know, Senator, I remember very clearly when U.S. representatives, whether they were senators or congressmen, went home for those town hearings, very often they'd fight with the people. They wouldn't listen. They'd argue with them.
Well, that's exactly right, Dave. And that, we did the exact opposite here in Florida. Before we formulated the policy, we listened to people. For example, with health care reform in Florida, we made it patient-centered. We listened to doctors, especially patients, and we listened to them, then formulated the legislation, and then listened to them again as they critiqued our ideas. We use your ears more than your mouth. You usually do a lot better. Too bad in Washington, they're too focused on talking instead of listening.
Well, Mayor, I got to admit, I think it's the payoffs. I think it's as simple as that. They don't want to use the word payoffs or bribes or kickbacks, but that's what's going on. When you have 200 of the top donors and bundlers of money for President Obama's campaign getting top jobs in the administration, that seems to me to be a payoff. If mayors did that, by the way, and any time a mayor does do that, when they appoint their relatives or their buddies or their money people to top position, they're accused, rightly so, I think, of corruption.
Of course.
Why doesn't it happen inside the Beltway?
Well, I think they're removed. You know, when you go off to Washington, it's a little bit difficult to follow up and to see exactly what changes are taking place. But to me, the largest message that's coming out of Washington is that government is that government is going to fix everybody's problem. That if you're unemployed or underemployed, government needs to take responsibility and figure out a way. When in reality, people just need the inspiration. They need the belief that if they'll make positive changes in their lives, they can live a better life.
Well, how do you do that? That means that you have to actually inspire people. There's not much
It's leadership
coming out of the
It's
Beltway.
Leadership, and it does need to come out of Washington. I'll tell you what, quick story. Yesterday, I get on the subway at 34th Street. I sit down, sit next to a guy. I don't know his financial situation, but probably not very good. He pulls out a piece of paper. He's drawing my picture. Where are you getting off? I said, 59th Street. He starts drawing faster. By the time I get off on 59th Street, he hands me this picture. Love it. Gave him $20. He created a job for himself. He made $20 between 34th and 59th Street. We need more people believing that they take responsibility for themselves and their own livelihood.
That's what this country is about. But I got to tell you, Senator, that I'm very discouraged. I have to honestly say that I've just about given up expecting for the kind of change in Washington that would be amenable to the anecdote that the mayor just talked about, because they're so insulated from what the people want and what the people are doing.
Well, I couldn't agree more. That's why, again, we need to go out and listen to people. In my real job, I'm a college professor. I listen to my students, and we have real constructive dialogue. And that's, again, what we did in Florida. We made five promises to the people of Florida before we got elected, to have a balanced budget without raising taxes, to put a spending limit in place, and take on the welfare program called Medicaid, and also reforming our pension system. We did those with promises, and we backed them up. In Washington, it's usually just a lot of talk, pointing fingers, and that's why Washington, D.C. is broken and why we need to send people there who's actually accomplished things instead of just talking about things.
All right. Well, you've done it in Florida. Mayor, you've done it in Oklahoma City. But how do you translate that success on the local level to the federal
level. Well, one thing you could do is have the voters determine their level of taxation. Have them allow them to vote on tax increases or decreases. That way it would give some sort of reliability and some sort of
efficiency. Some state houses actually, Senator, have done that, where they say that you have to any tax increase has to be voted on by a supermajority, for example. Shouldn't we have the same thing on the federal level?
Absolutely. The first thing I would do in Washington, D.C. is to pass a balanced budget amendment and a line item veto for the president. We need to put those constraints in on government. And this year in Florida, under my leadership, we actually passed a spending cap so that state spending does not grow faster than population and inflation. It gives that trust to the people, knowing that their dollars will not be spent when the government simply does not have them.
All right. Well, will the states lead the way in forcing D.C. to listen to the people? Is there a growing trend here? David Buckner is a Columbia University professor and runs Bottom Line Training and Consulting. And we still have the mayor and the state senator with us. My feeling is that you just have to starve the beast. The best way to cure this kind of patronage that you have going on inside the Beltway is just to diminish the role of government in our lives. Just starve the beast.
Well, David, you've got two things here. On a local level, it's like a home. If I don't pay my bills, there's no money. I have to file bankruptcy. With a local government, it's the same thing. When mayors have to sit down and say, there's no money, we either have to tax more or spend less. Mm-hmm. But when you get to the federal government, you get a larger level, they have these huge budgets, and they have not only a club, they have the ocean. And many people feel like, I can't move against the ocean. When I can channel a stream, I can't channel the ocean.
But that's exactly why, and I know all the reasons against default and the reasons against raising the debt ceiling, but that's why I am against raising the debt ceiling, because unless you force these guys to do it, they're not going to do it on their own.
David, we're not going to stop spending. The problem is when something comes back to them, there is no return to the investor, the shareholder, which is the taxpayer. There is a consumption mentality that begins again, and they buy more things.
What it is you need bankruptcy. You need the threat of bankruptcy. When we began bailing out these big corporations, including the auto companies, instead of letting them go bankrupt, maybe Citibank should have gone bankrupt. Maybe then it would have broken up and turned into a different kind of institution. Maybe then we would have had some creative solutions to the problems we're having instead of government support and bailouts. Unless we have the threat of a bankruptcy in front of us, whether we're a business or a country, we're doomed to fail.
Creative destruction is the way in which markets work. And if we don't allow it to work, we have moral hazard. What do we have now in the government? Moral hazard, the very same thing that bring out large corporations.
Well, Senator Haridopolos, you're very shortly, if you're successful, going to be inside the Beltway. How do you bring this message in there? What are you going to lobby to do? You said about a balanced budget, by the way, which I'm a little wary of as an answer, because many Democrats will use it as an excuse to raise taxes. Say, hey, we got to balance the budget, therefore let's raise tax rates.
Well, again, I've taken a no new tax pledge, and most importantly, instead of just talking about these things, we accomplished them in Florida. As the commentator mentioned, we have to have a balanced budget in Florida. We have no alternative. And when you put conservative leaders who've done it on the state level up in Washington, D.C., you get things done. I'm tired of the rhetoric. 2008 was about hope and change. Let's make 2012 about leadership and accomplishment. Don't raise the debt ceiling and make sure that we balance the budget. That means spending less. We had a $4 billion shortfall in Florida this year. Everyone thought we'd have to raise taxes, raise fees. We said no. We simply cut the spending, reform Medicaid, the biggest cost driver coming out of Obamacare, and we balanced the budget. It can be done if you send the right people to Washington who have proven to be leaders.
Well, Mayor, I think you have to have that dual mandate, though. You can't just have a budget balance amendment. What you also have to do is have the no tax pledge at the same time. You got to link those two. Otherwise, a lot of people just try to raise taxes.
Well, it's unfortunate, because what we really need is efficiency. But I don't necessarily like handcuffing the elected officials or the electorate if they get a chance to vote on it. But what we're really looking for is efficient government, and you can describe it any way you want.
What are businesses looking for? That's what you deal with day in, day out. You go around the world trying to help them to survive in this crazy environment that we have, and a lot of them, frankly, are choosing to leave the United States because we're so screwed
up. I've been
up.
In 12 countries in the last 8 weeks, and that is for American firms that are standing at the door saying, keep investing, we're on our way out. And that's because they don't know what the markets will allow them to do, and so they're hedging their bets by diversifying their risk. One thing you have to allow to happen is the market work. Anytime transfers take place, that's government. Anytime wealth is created, that's markets. You have to allow the markets to work. And transfer, which comes through government, doesn't allow for wealth creation. It's wealth destruction.
But they need certainty, don't they? They want to have a certain future. And right now they have such an uncertain future. They don't know what's coming next.
They need clarity. They need to understand whether these tax issues that they're dealing with in the next year or two are going to be fixed, or whether we're going to be exorbitant taxes that we can't absorb.
If you had those two mandates that the senator was talking about, a balanced budget amendment and a pledge not to raise any tax rates at all, would that dual pledge help our economy?
Those will help because it creates certainty. But you're going to find that unless we actually get the markets and businesses exchanging, you actually create creative destruction and people innovate. Those simple things there are ambulances waiting for something to happen rather than fences trying to encourage markets to flourish.
David Buckner, good to see you. State Senator Mike Haridopolos, thank you very much. Oklahoma City Mayor Mick Cornett, always a pleasure. Coming up on deck, the U.S. Senate says they ended